let's call this starts the 10% use case. We have been using Cassandra for quite some time, and the goal is to expose very interesting use cases, which I'm not familiar if most of the present speakers are utilizing. So we'll go into a bunch of details. So this is a quick agenda. The key word here is product. Almost everybody talking about Cassandra, big data, and all of this stuff is services, where you host the service. We seem to be the only one vendor who's actually shrink wrapping Cassandra and delivering it as a product. What exactly is telco grade? It seems like all products are held to the standard of telco grade or carrier grade. MySQL just came up with a cluster and called it the carrier grade edition. So what does it really mean by telco grade? That's something key for all of us to understand. The big data use cases that we face, and there'll be some metrics in there. We are the only vendor right now who provides an active messaging platform based on Cassandra, so we'll talk a little bit about that. And bulk of the presentation is focused on Cassandra insights, what we have learned, what helps in our use case, what may or may not help in some other use cases. So a little bit my background. I started working in building telco appliances in 2000, and I'm not sure if everybody knows, but there's a certification process that telcos go through called NEBS. Pulling a plug out of your network, making your appliance go through 8.5 Richter scale testing, things like that. In 2005, I got a chance to build like a mini BDB base, mini Cassandra, if you will. Lots of similar concepts, nothing close to a product, but lots very similar. Then I started working for Yahoo in 2006 and built lots of feedback loops with billions and billions of events. Needless to say, it's a place where Hadoop is considered slow, even by today's standards. Big data got defined very well in that era, if you will, and a lot of technologies that are coming out are kind of the artifacts of engineering done during those time frame. The key word here is that billions of events translate to dollars. Every clicks, every search, every ad that is being shown is actually dollars. So you can't afford to lose them. But at the same time, you also have dynamics of impressions, which are thousandth of a cent price versus clicks, which could be priced up to $10. So building infrastructures to scale both of that had some interesting challenges. And then, if that was not enough, I joined one of the top five hedge funds in 2008. Perfect timing, if you will. but essentially, all the hype that was surrounded during that time for building high-frequency trading, however evil you would like to call it, but from a systems perspective, really where issues like TCP are a problem, where GC is actually dollars. I mean, it's not like you go from 1 millisecond to two and there's a small hiccup. It's actually you lose a trade. And if you lose a trade, you lose money. Simple, all right? So, and you can look at my LinkedIn profile where I worked for, but these are one of the top five hedge funds. These are not the hedge funds which are going bankrupt right now. These are founded by people who are advisors to Obama and such. So really top tier, lots, billions of dollars is what I can say. So needless to say, I really enjoy distributed systems in a nutshell. And so I worked in the product space for quite some time, worked in the services space, and finally joined back in Openwave messaging for the product space. So this is what our portfolio kind of looks like, if you will. If you look at our website, it has gone through a whole bunch of transition, but fundamentally we build messaging platforms or products. And we have history of data technologies going back early 2000s, right? If you're using an AT&T phone right now, and if you're actually tweeting and using the data plan, it's going through our appliance every few hundred bytes, trying to check if you're not over the 2 gig limit or 5 gig limit or whatever be it. So really high transactional systems per day, billions and billions of transactions per day. And we have a whole bunch of kind of service architecture, if you will, where you have user profile stuff where, you know, very quick lookups, less writes. Then you have the bulk of messaging platforms. Many of you know email usage is going through the roof. Nobody deletes email anymore. So it has notions of high-performant email access for real-time transaction, but at the same time, archival characteristics for really large amounts of data, if you will. And all of this gets tied up with protocol stacks. You know, if you're using, smartphones are killing IMAP in a nutshell, so IMAP access becomes the key. In Japan, they wouldn't release an iPhone without MMS, so MMS is still the key. SMS is kind of there, but you know, we can probably consider it dead. But then there are a whole bunch of apps on top of these protocol stacks, which people are innovating on. And there are lots of startups who are starting in that space, mining your email. And then there are devices. Yeah. These are the three areas that we focus on and everything below. We don't play anything in the device space. And so we'll talk about where we use Cassandra a lot more. So this is just a slide to explain what telco grade is. And you know, I got to experience this firsthand talking to some of the customers. They're uber risk averse, first of all. And this comes from the tsunami in Japan a few years ago. But really, when you get to understand some of these customers, there's actually government regulation if a set of mailboxes go down for more than 30 minutes. And that gets bad press, which has consequences on you losing more money. What this means is you can't go to a website and it says, sorry, we're working, come back later. If that goes on for more than 30 minutes, you actually get reported in the press. That's the level of reliability that they are looking for. The tsunami really created a huge issue with business continuity planning, especially in Japan and other parts of the world. Being a product, footprint is a huge differentiator. You can't throw 300 machines and achieve 2 million transactions like some of the service companies do. We have to do it at a much smaller scale. They're trying to open up, but still have an embedded mindset. They still think embedded systems in a nutshell. These are some funny things that came along. We were talking to a few customers and started talking about the Cassandra deployment to say, I want 5 copies of data. Because they are uber risk averse, I want 5 copies of data. But you're going to cost transactional rate at the cost of, you know, keeping 5 copies. And they're like, OK, we are willing to pay for it. We are going to throw SSDs at it. But we want 5 copies of data. So again, unique things. I have never known of a server which actually listens to 2 physical IP addresses. You know, maybe DNS servers do, but if you look at a web server, if you look at any server, all network interface stuff is handled at the level below in an operating system level, but these guys, they want user-level software to listen to 2 physical LANs, if you will. And then they actually review our bug reports and FR quality processes to say that, are they going to deploy it or not? And the 5th 9 of the 5 9 reliability, you know, somebody said Amazon is 99.95% available. That's obviously not going to be acceptable to most telcos, right? And they have armies of people to test that 5th 9 of 5 9 reliability, literally armies, more than what our engineers can do. This is, again, the big data use cases that we have been working for. As you can see, we use a very heterogeneous data set in our deployment. We have user profile data where we have been using BDB and Oracle. Again, data set size and operations per second are kind of lined up. This is also an interesting aspect. When we look at big data, we really look at, is it billions of events of big data, or is it just raw, sheer big data growing exponentially along with a very high transaction rate? And the key message here is that those are the 2 areas where we are trying to use Cassandra right now, which is kind of lots and lots of data, but with a very high transaction rate. And mail is an interesting application. It's kind of, in some sense, a little bit of an anomaly for Cassandra because it's read heavy, and you'll see why. A little bit of history. We started using Cassandra about 2+ years ago. In Jonathan's slide with all the customers last year, we were one of them right there, and we are still there. It's shipped as part of a shrink wrap product. It's not a service. It's not something we host. It's actually given to our customers. Customers don't care that there is Cassandra behind the covers. They just care whether the product works or not, as spec'd. So using C++ thrift access and super columns, this is also one of the anomalies. Most people are not familiar with, you know, they're used to Hectors or SQL or one of these higher level abstractions. We go much below to the bare metal. And for example, some of the things we did was, before compression was there in Cassandra, we introduced application level compression ourselves. And the last bullet is very interesting. You know, roughly, we have 50% reads, we have up and delete ratio of 30%, and true updates, you know, something which is actually changing state, only 20%. And we have different levels of reliability for each one of these. The reads are actually very interesting, and I'll explain why. This is the active-active deployment architecture that we actually went live with. And I can easily say that up to 50 million plus mailboxes are going to go live by end of this year. And this has been an interesting voyage for us because it started 2 years ago. And two customers, two of the biggest telcos in very different parts of the world using this in a very different way are going to go live with this platform. Fundamentally, we have what we call FEPs, which are nothing but the IMAP POP servers, talking to some data access layer, which then talks to Cassandra or Thrift or S3. S3 is, again, we can use cloud storage as we want to, or you can use the in-house EMC, Scality, or one of the vendors which provide S3 appliances. And the interesting part is that we use Cassandra for both meta and blob. The metadata of a message is basically, you know, who sent you the message, who received you, you know, flags, stuff like that. Pretty small size, if you will. The message is actually the bulk of the body. If you think about Twitter messages, every message is 160 characters or less. We need to worry about anywhere from 160 characters to 20 megabytes of message size. Those are the average message size that we deal with, which is the hard problem, right? I mean, trying to scale a database for a 160-byte message just over and over again is achievable, but having a single backend which actually scales for all of those dataset sites is a very interesting challenge. This is an example medium-scale deployment. Again, very interesting. So the message metadata, which is the structured data, you know, your columns, names, values, and pairs, we have roughly 20 nodes, and it's interesting to note these numbers because you know, look at each node. Each node is kind of really, really powerful, right? So we have up to 24 cores with hyper-threading, anywhere from 300 gig to about 1.2 gig of SSD-based storage, only SSD, no rotational media. Roughly 5K Cassandra operations per second per node is the key here. And then the blob data, we are talking about 15 nodes, but look at the amount of storage. It's one node is responsible for 280 terabytes of store. And you know, we have an external disk array with 20 terabytes of store or whatnot. The key thing to keep in mind here is that these are really dense nodes in some sense, and they're expected to grow 30% year over year. And you know, since I worked at Yahoo, I can completely understand why this is a challenge. You know, it's very interesting to throw machines which are underutilized and just horizontally spread out by breadth. But it's very hard to actually scale with a footprint. You know, one box, how can you optimize it as best as possible? And what kind of other ripple effects it has, like, you know, how do you do recovery and, you know, what happens when you're trying to get 280 terabytes rsynced from another server, stuff like that. So this, I hope this is going to be the bulk of the insights that we found working with Cassandra for our use cases, right? Replication factor, one of the biggest impact to your overall operations per second. I mean, it's very interesting. We have to teach our customers that, you know, there is a cost to replication. Although it's obvious, but there's a cost. It's, even though Cassandra makes it easy, there is a cost. And the cost is that the first RF jump, when you first go from copy of one to copy of two, is the largest kind of jump, hardest hit. But the second key part is, and this is something we discovered like about 8 months ago, is especially when you do stuff in lab, how big is your ring size to the replication factor ratio plays a huge role in defining how much you can scale, right? So these are two very interesting aspects to keep in mind with regards to replication factor. Tombstones. Again, it's one of these interesting artifacts of eventual consistency, which we had a huge impact on. And lots of our applications, especially mail, are delete heavy. You get a message, it's stored for like 30 seconds, it gets deleted very quickly. And that causes a lot of problems because now you're generating immense amount of tombstones. And if you don't manage them well and you don't size for them, then you could have a lot of problems. The other part is application level soft delete. So if you think of mail as an application, by definition, a trash can is a tombstone in some sense, right, at a very high level. And what ends up happening is that if you don't refactor your application to avoid those soft deletes, then you actually have your application soft delete and create an application tombstone. Then the backend system actually cleaning up that tombstone. And in our case, because we also have the blob data, that gets cleaned up later. So you have like three or four tiers of maintenance running to delete the same data over and over again. So you need to understand that the application actually needs to adapt to a backend, which allows for eventual consistency. And deletes is a very important use case in that. And obviously, once you account for those kinds of maintenance, you have to plan for the compaction, repair, and read latencies. Because especially when you're trying to read when and maintenance is going on, you will get non-deterministic read latencies. And for real-time applications, you have to size your system for that. And I'll talk about sizing a little bit. The sizing for us comes from some of our customers. They plan for the perfect storm, right? They always plan. They are not like the banks who plan for only one thing can go wrong at a time. They plan for five things can go wrong at the same time, right? So they plan for maintenance is going on in the night. There are a bunch of failures, and system goes back to some level of, you fail over to the other node who has the data copy. And then at the same time, you have another node join the ring and a recovery starts. So your load on the single server, which is handling that data, actually goes up by 3x or 4x. So you need to size for that. The next two issues are very interesting because disk failures, as I just said, one node is handling like up to 300 terabytes of data. And since Cassandra doesn't handle disk failures very well, it was required that we go with the JBOD approach. So we are working with DataStax to actually kind of get that addressed as sooner as possible. Because for us, that's key. You know, handling, we can't deploy it as a blob store if that's not fixed. The denormalization client cost. So we don't like joins, and you know, joins are evil. The cost of it is that an application now needs to maintain accuracy of data across column families within Cassandra. What that does is that there are a bunch of round trips going back and forth from your client application. You have to plan for if I added in record here and if the record didn't get added here, what's the right order in which everything goes through? There's an immense amount of overhead that your application needs to handle. And again, you know, whenever we talk, you know, I was talking to Jonathan and Ben and others, and I said, but most of the time, most of the things don't fail, and that's true. But when they do, you need to account for those. And to account for those is very, very cumbersome, especially for applications like us, where you have multiple data stores, but you also have multiple column families, which kind of act like data stores. And finally, this is the one that has been the Achilles heel for us, reliable counters. Not sure how many of you know the IMAP protocol, but IMAP is a very evil protocol in some sense, right? Let's put it that way. So it uses really bad, you know, it uses UID as a sense of time, clients cache the UID, your phones could get messed up, there could be a sense of data loss. I mean, really bad things can happen if you mess up the UID. And we went on debating this over and over and over again with Jonathan and others, and said, look, you know, it's probably not the best fit. You know, let's not try to, don't try to fit something to a product which is not designed for, right? So put in a MySQL, it's gonna be 15 gig of SSD space, whatever, you know, it'll be done. Two machines, it'll take care of it. Don't try to abuse it, and don't try to mess with it, because if you mess with it, you can have really bad ramifications. These are the other three insights which are not universally applicable, and again, this is why we are the 10% use case. GC overhead in Cassandra because of, you know, again, many of these have improved over years, over the last year, but some of these are key for us. So we reduced the number of columns, we actually concatenated columns. We manage column names within an application because 70% of garbage in Java is strings, so get rid of them. Again, pretty embedded stuff, but required. And the final one was chunking within the application. So because we handle large blobs, we have to do chunking so that memory pressures are optimized for Java. And the last one, which we are just doing right now, is every single time when there is a GC or a major activity happening in the backend, the client side gets a hiccup, right? So if you go from a 6 millisecond latency to 10 millisecond latency, that's how much busy your connection is. And because your connection get that busy, depending on how your application is, you need to start managing that very well with queuing or whatnot. And we have had, again, this is why we are the 10% use case, we have had thundering herd syndromes on our client side where a lot of pressure gets backlogged in the client because the pipe to the Cassandra node is backlogged. So that sizing is very key for production scale. This is just another tidbit. Again, just showing how much Cassandra has come. This is a memory graph. I'm not sure if all of it is visible, but just over a 4-hour period when we are running load test on this system, this is a graph of a C++ process versus a Java process. It's not a guess, but that's the Cassandra JVM, and that's a C++ application with Smart Heap. So this is for people, especially for someone like me who worked in Java in the hedge fund industry, who worked in C++ in clustered appliances. There are people who still debate the discussion between Java and C++. And frankly, a well-written Java app can beat memory management from an operating system perspective, hands down, to even something like a C++ application with Smart Heap. And this is like with us squeezing every single juice out of it. So a lot of amazing improvements from a garbage collection perspective in Cassandra. But again, it's very well written, and you know, we kind of grab the code every single time we look for some of this stuff. So finally, Cassandra and OpenWave messaging, right? I was trying to describe this in, you know, conclude in a very interesting way, but what it really boils down to is that it's a distributed system symphony, right? And the word symphony is the key. It's a lot of small distributed system stuff which is getting perfectly integrated in a good enough way, right? And it's getting perfected. It's come an amazing way, if you will. Especially things like replication, partitioning, how do you recover, how do you do fault tolerant, how do you scale. The SEDA architecture is truly amazing. I mean, I used SEDA architecture in 2001, but the way it has been optimized, it can use only 2 TCP sockets to handle backend transactions. Truly amazing. And from our perspective, if you look at it, we have the perfect set of distributed system challenges, right? We have to solve all of these problems at scale with a dense footprint, with very resilient systems, with probably those 5 guys sitting in the back right there. There isn't an army of developers who are trying to fix these problems, which is the key, right? I mean, if you get an army of smart engineers and pay them, yeah, sure, you can do anything you want, but getting it to do with 5 folks or 10 folks is amazing. And that's why it's the 10% use case. It's not the 90% use case. And finally, obviously, we are hiring. So the key is data-driven engineers, not developers, not coders, but engineers who fret the details. They understand true scale impacting millions of users daily. Again, simplicity. So if somebody says I can scale to 3 billion transactions, the first question I want to be asked is how many machines, what are the number of connections, what the number of threads, not just numbers on the PowerPoint slide. They care about building OS-level resilient systems. Our benchmark is an operating system. At the end of the day, you need to see an uptime of 365 days. If you can do that, that's what we want to talk about. And finally, we want to work with leaders who are engineers at heart. My boss, Rich, who's sitting right here, you know, the kind of stuff we talk is he has a hobby of software-defined radios. And we talk about how he writes software-defined radios on Mac and stuff, and you know, there's some buffering going on. And we said, hey, we could use SEDA to actually optimize the buffering speeds and all that. It's truly amazing to actually work with people who understand engineering. And so that's essentially it. I guess I don't have any questions, but thank you. Yeah, we're definitely not going above that. So we do interesting deployment topologies where even before Cassandra had the SSD for something and HDD, what we would do is we would deploy 2 JVMs, one running the meta part and one running the blob part. So we would actually use some of these things ourselves ahead of time and obviously tune the heap accordingly.